Welcome to Conversations with Karin, whereby I have weekly conversations with you regarding life and unlocking your full potential to possibly shift, change, and grow through our conversations. Today's guest is Jurie Wessels, who is an integral coach and psychometrist. Am I correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Welcome, Jurie, to today's conversation.
Thank you so much, Karin. I'm happy to be here. Yeah.
I've been wanting to do this for a while with you. The theme for today, or for the next couple of weeks, actually, is going to be about mental health. And today's conversation is going to be defining who you are. One of the many secrets of becoming mentally strong. Hi, I'm Karin Kelly, a transformation coach and author, assisting you to unlock your full potential, to shift, change, and grow, transforming the essence of self, discarding, upgrading past programming that have limited you and held you back. In other words, assisting, for example, assisting you getting unstuck in your thoughts, for example. So, recently, I was pulled aside by a young individual that wanted to know if they could talk to me. And the individual went straight into why they wanted to talk to me, what they wanted to talk to me about, without actually introducing themselves. We went off to a secluded little spot room, and I said, yes, I would actually hear her out. And the frustration and almost desperation, yearning of wanting to know or to solve something, the energy that she was giving off was strong. I kept quiet and just listened. And as the conversation was going, she kept on saying, I am bipolar, and I want to study this, and I want to delve, and I want to know why, because I am bipolar. And basically, she defined herself. Anyway, I listened. And then I said to her, what's your name? Oh, sorry, it's bipolar. And she looked, and they looked at me shocked. And I said, but that's who you defined yourself by. He said, hi, I'm bipolar. Hi, I'm Mr. Procrastinator. Hi, I'm Miss Absent-Minded. Hi, I'm stuck in my thoughts. And not hi, I'm Karin. And I explained to her that about defining herself as bipolar. I saw her as an artist. I saw, like, you know, a puzzle or a painting. And some artists, they're very expressive and demonstrative. And when they get angry, for example, they'll push the puzzle, for example, they'll push the puzzle at the table and it breaks. And then they go, oh my word, what have I just done? And they'd have to pick the puzzle up and put the puzzle back together. And that's how I actually saw her, as an artist, where sometimes she throws her toys out of a cart, or she has a bad day because it's just too much for her to take in what she's actually taking in, and she pushes the puzzle off and she has to put those puzzles back together, making sure that the puzzles she puts together, the blueprint that she puts together, basically back together, is hers, not somebody else's. So she discards what doesn't belong to her. She looked at me and she said, oh, I've never thought of it like that. I never realized what I was doing. I don't know if you find that, Jurie.
No, absolutely. I think a lot of people would find, you know, defining ourselves is very important for our sense of selves. And we have many different selves. And especially when people latch onto diagnoses like that, like bipolar or ADHD or things like that, they can tend to define themselves in the parameters of this diagnosis. And with that, it limits them. It limits them in the fact that they can then also use that diagnosis as an excuse. That it's not me, it is my bipolar or my ADHD that's not allowing me to focus or work effectively in relationships, etc., without taking that necessarily responsibility. And if you look at an individual, especially like a teenager or something like that, there are many sources of information that can actually contribute to their sense of definition, yet they choose the negative sources. Like, I'm the procrastinator, I'm that, but what about the fact that you're first team rugby captain, or you in the chess club or something like that? Why not choose those aspects to actually define yourself? And we have this, I also see this negative bias in choosing the negative aspects to define ourselves. So no, absolutely, I see this a lot with the work that I do.
You know, have you, the audience that's listening, is have you, example on Facebook or Instagram or TikTok, your friends, they're not actually close friends, they're just associate friends or Facebook friends or acquaintances, whose life seems perfect. They live in a gorgeous house, a really rewarding career, and the family go on all these beautiful, exciting adventures together on the weekend. And I swear, they must take a professional photographer along with them, because no matter where they go or what they do, the whole family just looks beautiful. And they put how grateful they are, and probably they actually mean it. Or you actually start to tend to wonder when you see these people. And you wonder, why are people doing better than you? Why is somebody doing better than me? You're putting in the work. You're actually probably working harder. So you start to question yourself. And researchers have found that envying your friends on Facebook or in life in general actually leads to depression, feeling that you're not good enough. And that's one of the traps that our mind, our thoughts, can set us up. Hey, Yuri?
No, absolutely. And, you know, even with Facebook, social media, Instagram, TikTok, all that, it's the highlights reel of that person's life. And research has also indicated that the more friends you have on social media, the more likely you are to be depressed.
Seriously?
Because you have more people to actually compare your life to. And, you know, when you work as a coach with people or a psychologist or a counselor, you go very deep and you see what happens behind the scenes. And a few of my clients will talk about the anxiety and dread that they feel when they anticipate like a day like Christmas, where they have to pose for this perfect photo where everyone's clothes are perfectly white and steamed and pressed and everything, and the anxiety that comes with that. But yet the photo looks perfect, and that's what the rest of the world sees, and that is their kind of highlights reel. And we also have to ask ourselves, a person that is so active on these social media sites to constantly show the positive, why do they have such a need to do that? Whereas a person who really has such a positive life wouldn't necessarily want to advertise it to the rest of the world. So it's very difficult to actually think critically when we're just looking through our phones at these social media sites. And our brains take these things in, and we might think that, you know, our lives might not meet up to par or things like that. And therefore, the less people you have on social media, the more likely you are to be happy. But that doesn't suggest, you know, the relationships are the most important aspects of life. You know, I mean, it's not necessarily the amount of people, you know, it's the quality and depth of the few relationships that you actually have. Those are the things that's really important in life. And yeah, and especially now with everyone having a microphone and advertising their lives all over the world, it becomes really difficult to actually define who we are in this period, what we're doing and all that. And our definition of self is also what buffers us from mental health difficulties, etc. So yeah, I think it's a very interesting topic that you chose here, Karin.
You know, I'm going to give, because we only got 20 minutes to 30 minutes, is there some techniques. So how do you shift those mental habits? Because let's face it, it's mental habits. It doesn't even need to be social media, because you might actually see somebody or a friend or whatever and think those thoughts. Why? I'm doing everything that I can and I'm just not succeeding. And that's what we call energetically, energy. You can learn that school, everything's energy. And your thoughts, also energy, okay? So it goes out there, what you send out there comes back. So what is that sport that you hit against the wall? Two people hit it against the wall and bounce and squash.
That's it. Squash. I'm a squash.
So you can actually relate.
Yes.
Yeah. So how do you shift this? Mental thoughts is we start off with our thoughts, our mind, which, by the way, is your biggest trickster. Number one is that you need to be prepared to put in the work, which I call mind mastery. It's like you come into Jurie or myself, and we tell you and give you exercise and we give you a suggestion or whatever it might actually be, and you think you're going to walk out of there healed, changed, transformed. You have to put in the work. We are living in two worlds simultaneously. The outer world, which is situations and circumstances, and the inner world, our consciousness and our thoughts. Two different worlds. Example, right now you are sitting in a room, possibly sitting in a room, listening to me, sitting in a chair, the couch, possibly with people around you. That's your outer world. The inner world, have your attention. Or you're driving a car. Think of yourself driving a car. You don't even think about it while you're busy driving. Your outer world, you're sitting in the car, you're driving. Left indicator, right indicator, stop, whatever it might actually be. But inside the car, you're having other thoughts, either about your budget or the beach or your children or the next webinar you're going to run. So we live in a state of reaction. Thus, we have no power, and I do this because we have no power regarding our thoughts, our inner world. Happiness exists inside. Confidence exists inside. Love exists inside. You can't bring confidence to a room and touch it. The power comes when we realize our consciousness is limited to our outer world. In other words, it works independently. So in other words, we have control of our thoughts. In other words, so watch your thoughts and start to shift them. Because your thoughts can have a field day. I must now do the exercise, for example, for 5 minutes working on my thought pattern, for example, or you do affirmations or whatever it might actually be. Your name, too tired. No, I've still got to do this. No, do you think it's you? It's your thoughts controlling you. Hello? Start controlling your thoughts. Watch your thoughts and start to shift them.
So, yeah, it's very interesting what you say about thoughts. And interestingly, there's only two things that we are actually in control of in our world. There's our thoughts and our behavior. And as you earlier spoke about energy, energy is always, or electricity is always going to take the path of least resistance, which is why if you go on safari or something like that, you'll find most of the animals walking in the road because it's easier. They wouldn't want to walk necessarily where there's a lot of resistance. So if you've thought in a certain pattern for a certain period of your life, let's say you're 27 years of age and you've consistently thought that you're not good enough, your thoughts are naturally going to take that path. Yeah. Now, the thing is, I mean, South Africa is also a very good example of how to get rid of something like that. You know, if a tar road has been developed, you know, and we just kind of leave that tar road, what happens? You know, potholes will start developing, grass will start growing through. Eventually, the grass will grow through and there's not a path anymore. So essentially, it's about how do we control our thoughts? It's firstly becoming aware of them and knowing that every healthy person on the planet has negative thoughts. I mean, Aaron Beck proved this in the 1970s when he started cognitive behavioral therapy, that we all have automatic negative thoughts, that I don't think I'm good enough, or imposter syndromes or things like that. And the thing is, if you actually were to sit down and objectively sit and gather evidence on your life to actually contribute to that thought that you're not good enough or to dispel it, you might actually realize there's a lot more evidence to suggest that you are actually good enough. And that's where a trained coach comes in to allow you to objectively look at your life and just bring up that awareness around your thoughts. And essentially your thoughts and ties into your identity and the fact that it's how you make sense of your identity through language. And your language and your thoughts are intricately connected. So how we speak to ourselves, how we make sense of the world, that type of thing, has a huge impact on who we are and type of energies that we actually express out to the world. Like, for example, if you're very lonely, if you're a single person and you really want a partner in your life, and you're desperate to find a partner, it's very hard to actually find one. But as soon as you actually forget about getting a partner and you just want to focus on yourself, your hobbies, your interests, and those type of things, you start exerting the right type of energies, you actually attract the right partner to you. So, yes, I think, you know, thoughts and our identities and just being aware of where our identities come from is very important. Mm. I mean, if you look at COVID, the impact that it had on teenagers was immense. I saw a lot of youngsters who would cope fine, you know, get average academic grades, but they'll be brilliant on the sport field. And then COVID hit, now they can't do sports anymore and their anxiety shoots through the roof. They start with acting out rebellious behavior because they don't have that source of identification anymore. Mm. I'm not that first team rugby player anymore. I'm not the top squash player in the school anymore. So what am I? How do people actually define me? And yes, it becomes a real big topic in adulthood, but when it's really pertinent is during adolescence. 14, 15 years of age is where we've got to find that little clique, that little group, that pack at school. And those little groups start identifying as a certain group. And then they'll start identifying other groups as the outer group. And that's where stereotypes start developing, all sorts of things like that, all based on the insecurity of the individual. And it's very interesting. This is based on the realistic conflict theory. It was very interesting how you can tell a group of kids, teacher did this. She said, all the brown-eyed kids are clever and all the blue-eyed kids are not that clever. And after 3 months, the mark started reflecting that. And then she said, guys, you know what I said in the beginning of the year, I made such a mistake. It was the opposite. So all the blue-eyed kids are actually clever and the brown-eyed kids aren't. And after 3 months, the marks reflected that just because they identified as that.
Poor kids.
Yeah. But it shows you how pertinent that identification actually is.
You know that when adults do come to me, and most of the time, a lot of the time, most of the time, is that the blueprint within them is not theirs.
Yes.
So they've developed those insecurities, being stuck, being in pain, and not being able to move forward, procrastinating, whatever it might actually be, searching their soul's essence, searching who they really are, boils down to way back. And a lot of the time, 90% of the time, they are shocked that an incident, either in school, when they were 4 years old as a child, or even in the womb, because to me things happen already from the womb stage, is that it affects them into adulthood. And what Yuri was actually saying now, it's very important when you're young. But you know, as parents, we try, or We try our best. And we learn, change, and grow. And hopefully our children learn, change, and grow. And so things develop. But it's very important that, now speaking as adults, that bits and parts of your blueprint that doesn't belong there needs to be discarded. And you need to be sitting in there. So some of your insecurities, for example, that Jurie mentioned. I wanted to read something to you that I typed up that I'm busy doing a 4-week or 5-week webinar masterclass on mind mastery. And it goes in conjunction with what Jurie mentioned to us. Thoughts that are emotionalized become magnetized, attracting similar like thoughts. When a thought is thought with emotion, it changes the dynamic of the thought, energy. How? It emotionalizes it, it magnetizes it. And once it magnetizes, it attracts similar like thoughts. And you're going to rewind that, because when I did that exercise about 6 years ago, and I really thought about it, I think it took me the third day that I went, oh my word, what have I been doing? So we are coming to an end in our conversation. There's a lot to actually speak about mental health. And we'll have Jurie back on here before he gets too busy. So, Jurie, is there anything you would like to say to our viewers before we end?
Yeah, look, I think the big thing that I've noticed, especially since the pandemic hit and all of that, is that a lot of people live very, very sheltered lives. And what that does is, if we only have a few sources of our identities, like, you know, I'm a very good gamer, or I'm very good at mathematics or something like that, but it's only one or two sources of information, we're putting all our eggs into one basket, we're actually living quite a risky life. Because what if you identify as a sportsman but you get injured? What then? And what also happens is, you know, an organism, as you said, you know, we have our inner being and then our outer being. Our inner being has to make sense of our outer world. And it's understandable that a lot of us want to stay within our comfort zones. But when we stay in our comfort zones, we're not actually progressing forward. We're actually just staying safe. And we're not challenging the nervous system to new experiences, etc. By going out, and I see parents doing this. I sit with children who are 15, 16 years of age, and they tell me when they're on holiday, they're not allowed to go swim on their own, yet they swim for the school or their water polo champions. And their moms and dads are so afraid to let them out and just explore nature on their own or something like that. And I think the problem with that is it creates an enmeshed relationship. It creates anxiety. It creates worry that there are dangers out there that's out of our control. Yet by exposing yourself incrementally to these dangers actually makes you stronger. And I think a lot of children are now being raised in a very, very sheltered type of environment, where what that also does, and yes, I mean, our world has definitely changed. We can't just let our kids play around in the streets anymore, etc. But it's also about what the parents and what everyone else does in their free time. You know, if you're going to do the exact same thing in your free time and not exiting your comfort zone, your thought patterns and energies will all stay on a very similar type of trajectory. But if you expose yourself to new adventures, new things, like let's say going on a road trip, even though you've never done it before, you might get lost, which is a very good thing, because then you'll rely on your resources to deal with it. And by doing those things, you actually start building up more evidence to contribute to your identity. And then you go into, let's say, a job interview, and it's a very anxiety-provoking situation. But you can then be reminded, hold on, 2 weeks ago I was stuck in the middle of the desert with a flat tire, and I made a plan. That was worse than this, and I handled that, therefore I can handle this. Yeah. So yeah. It's about regulating thoughts, gaining awareness of thoughts, and exposing yourself to new experiences, especially in adulthood. The older you get, if you learn a new language, go live in a new culture, those type of things, traveling is so good for the brain and so good for your sense of identity. I mean, there's a quote that says, no person that ever traveled can be racist. And I think that speaks a lot to it, because it just gives you that worldly experience.
You need to put in the work, like I said in the very beginning. You need to put in the work. You cannot leave a coach, counselor, psychiatrist, psychologist, whatever you go, you cannot leave and think a miraculous change and transformation is going to take place. You need to put in the work. And a simple example is going to the gym. And after many, many years, I talk from experience, you get on one of the bikes and you only last 4 minutes. And my muscles were so sore, besides my back, my muscles were very, very sore. But after 2 weeks of practicing going regularly, I then got to 10 minutes, eventually 20 minutes, and then half an hour, because I practiced those muscles. And our thought, our mind, is not used to exercising. So we need to exercise that muscle. And if you want to contact Jurie or myself, our details are streaming down below, and there's going to be an end slide with all our details down below to actually learn and be taught the techniques of moving forward in your life and getting unstuck in your thoughts. So, are you ready or wanting to reach your full potential? Reach out to me or Jurie. I'm echoing very badly. I believe it's on your side, Jurie. The question is fear holding you back? Is suppressed emotions holding you back? Are you feeling stuck in your thoughts? Are you wanting to develop your self-worth? Are you wanting to break the root of self-sabotage? Then you're in the right place by watching us. Whereby, I know I do, I'm sure Jurie does as well, is I assist you to unlock your full potential, to shift, change, and grow, transforming the essence of self. Discard and upgrade past programming that have limited you and held you back. And I'm just thinking of Jurie that works, he does work with adults, but also young teenagers. That is actually marvelous. We actually work helping to shift and change the essence of himself at that age already, to discard and upgrade their programming that have limited them from that age. Imagine as adults what they're going to be. They're going to fly. So it is about assisting you in taking a quantum leap forward in transforming your life on all levels, mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually, and energetically. So my question to all of you is, who do you choose to be? Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jurie, for being on the Conversations with Karin.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been wonderful.
Are you going to be back? Okay, I'm putting you on the spot.
No, definitely. I've had a lot of fun, and it's always good to chat with you, Karin. So yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Just let me know when.
And you know what is very interesting before I end is that I came from the adult perspective and Jurie came from almost like the teenager into adult. So it was actually very interesting, you know, the conversation. So remember to hit the subscribe button and like button if you would like to hear future talks. Be safe and be you. Thank you.